Please be as tough as you want and ask all the questions that you've always wanted to ask. Basically, we are going to do a balance sheet of your performance, of your government's performance in the 10 years between 2004 and 14, and then contrast it with what the NDA did. Who wants to go first? Mahesh, why don't you... You want to start from that end? Jaggi, why don't you go first, since you're... Let
about the future, not the past.
Okay. Jaggi, why don't you go first, since you have been notoriously critical of the UPA's performance and excessively laudatory, some would say, of the Modi government's performance. Go ahead.
I'm critical of the economic performance of both the UPA and the NDA.
Go ahead.
I think both of them made a hash of some parts of the economy. So my question to Mr. Chidambaram is this. You had fairly high growth years in UPA 1 and even in parts of UPA 2. But jobs did not grow except in a brief period between 2009 and 2011. Okay. And that was a period when the economy went for a tailspin, and you were also not the finance minister at that time. So during the time you were finance minister, no jobs grew, there were very little jobs growth. Now, how do you explain this fact of very high growth and very low jobs growth at that point?
Well, I don't agree that jobs did not grow. What jobs are you referring to? Are you referring to jobs in the organized sector or referring to jobs in India's informal sector, which accounts for about 90% of India's economy? The point is that if jobs did not grow and joblessness as we find today was the situation then, it would have come to a boil. It didn't come to a boil. In fact, jobs were created. It's not the ILO definition of a decent job. But because of that kind of growth, which allowed SMEs to grow, MSMEs to grow, and organized sector to grow at a high rate, jobs were indeed created, and joblessness had not become a crisis situation as we find today. Today, wherever you go, wherever I go at any event, wherever I go, whoever I talk to, trains, airplanes, party meetings, marriage hall, marriage functions, the only thing that people ask me is, can you find my son a job? There are simply no jobs today. It's reached a boiling point. Therefore, please don't compare the UPA's high growth and allegedly low job and the NDA's fake high growth numbers and the low jobs.
Jayati Ghosh, you want a follow-up, quick follow-up question, because the figures don't necessarily match what you say, Mr. Chidambaram.
Yes. There are no figures to show that.
You know, there's no figures to show that there was...
And your growth was actually higher. So how do you explain the disconnect between high growth and jobs, very low growth? Because the employment elasticity in the Indian economy has crashed, and it started crashing after 1990s. The thing, it was a 0.01 now. So even if you have high growth, even if by chance UPA 3 comes and says we get growth back to 10%, you're not going to solve the problem.
We'll tell you in our manifesto how jobs can be created, and that gives you an opportunity at that time to critique our manifesto.
It's always easier, of course, to be in the opposition than the government. But go ahead, Dr. Jayati Ghosh.
You know, I don't really want to talk about the past so much. And Mr. Chidambaram just mentioned the manifesto. And of course, we don't know what's in it yet. But we have already heard Mr. Rahul Gandhi talk about a universal basic income.
And not UBI.
Okay,
it's an adaptation of the principle.
A minimum income guarantee. Now, we don't know the details of it. It's clearly not worked out fully. It appears, at least some representatives of the Congress Party have suggested something very bizarre and unworkable, like figuring out the income of every household, having a minimum threshold.
That?
Praveen Chakravarti, whom I'm told is helping you in your manifesto. Anyway.
I don't think he spoke for the manifesto.
I think what Dr. Ghosh is saying, is it a jumla? Rahul Gandhi suddenly decided one day we are doing a minimum income guarantee scheme. It's not been worked out.
Rajdeep, I haven't finished my question.
Yes, please go ahead.
It's mine, not yours.
Yes, okay. Go ahead.
So, what I wanted to ask is, isn't it a much more feasible option to think of a universal basic services, universal pensions, and universal right to work?
So you've
Why
asked,
don't you think of a feasible strategy rather than some crazy scheme of measuring every household's income and filling in the difference?
You've asked a very important question. This is not a crazy idea born in some drunken party. We have consulted eminent international economists, and two or three of them are helping us work through the idea.
But the ones who were mentioned say they weren't consulted, like Angus Deaton and so on.
Abhipan?
Angus Deaton was mentioned. He said he wasn't consulted.
No. I'm not taking names. You take a name and you shoot it down. What can I do? I'm not taking names. All I'm saying is, I suppose you will accept that what I say with some sense of responsibility. We are consulting eminent economists. They have agreed to help us work it through. It's not a crazy idea. It's an idea born after thought. You can shoot it down after it's worked out. It's an idea born after careful thought. All that Congress president has articulated, we want to implement this idea. We're going to take it forward. Now we're working on it. We have thought it through. We have thought through the steps. We have also got a fair idea of the burden on the economy.
So can you tell us the steps?
No, I can't. I can't. I simply can't. Because the contours will be unveiled in the manifesto, and the details can only be announced if and when we are in government, in a proper statement to parliament. We are certainly not going to use this platform.
Huge advantage of being in the opposition, where you can unveil this scheme.
Which is why I'm saying the BJP should more often sit in the opposition.
Okay, let's get Dr. Chennai.
Thank you very much. Dr. Chennai, you spoke about growth and exports, and I want to step back a bit. You know, if you look at the last 25 years, growth has averaged about 6.5%. What's less appreciated is the important role of exports in our economy. Exports have grown at 11% in those 25 years, twice as strong as growth. And exports have come under pressure the last 3-4 years.
That's an understatement. If you take the 315 billion merchandise export achieved in 2014-15, that number was not crossed in the first 4 years of the Modi government. Whether it will cross on 31-3-2019, we have to wait and see.
So I have a two-part question. One is, precisely when India's got this big demographic bulge, the global economy is both slowing down and becoming more protectionist. And we may not get this export tailwind that China got and all of Asia got for 30 years. So the two-part question is, A, how do we make our exports more competitive? How do we join these global value chains? Do you advocate a weaker exchange rate? But the more fundamental question is, if you don't get double-digit export growth rate, because no country has grown at 9% for 30 years without 15% export growth, what will be the growth drivers of the next 10, 15 years be? What will those growth drivers be if it isn't exports?
See, today, the only one of the four factors that is driving economic growth is government expenditure. Private consumption was driving growth, but even that has slowed down. Maybe it'll pick up. But exports is not driving growth at all. In fact, exports have been absolutely sluggish and flat. Negative. If you take 5-year period, export growth is negative. We'll have to have a comprehensive strategy to push exports. We'll have to identify the sectors that have export potential and use well-tried, well-tested methods to push exports through those sectors. Gems and jewelry, leather, textiles. But that's not enough. We'll have to become a manufacturing hub and an exporter of manufactured goods. Somehow, Indian industry, manufacturing part of Indian industry, does not seem to be quite clued in on how to push out manufactured goods. We did very well in software. We did very well in these traditional industries like gems and jewelry, textiles, etc., etc. India's manufacturing sector doesn't seem to be clued in onto how to push exports. We are thinking about it. We have to find ways about it. The manifesto will indicate one or two ways, but I can't say we have all the answers yet. But I know where the problem is. The problem is India's manufacturing sector must become a sector that is oriented towards exports.
Just a quick follow-up here. How much of this is trying to ensure that our SMEs, who we romanticize a lot about, actually grow up? I'll just give one example, the apparel sector, where China did very well for 3 decades. We thought it was our turn next. Hasn't lived up to potential. If you look at that sector, 80% of people in apparels and textiles work in firms of 8 people or less. In China, it's 80% of people in that sector working in firms of 500 and more. Really hard to compete at those levels. Is some of this focus have to be on liberalizing labor laws so we incentivize firms to grow and then create jobs and compete globally?
So I don't think labor laws are a constraint on SME growth. I don't think MSMEs, or MS at least, are really constrained by labor laws. Hardly anyone applies those labor laws to M and S, and hardly anyone pulls up M and S of that MSME because they violated labor laws. You see, the romanticizing that you mentioned is 50% of our exports, or nearly 50% of our exports, come from SMEs. But that's not really finished goods. They are really producing parts, components. I don't think our SMEs are capable of producing final goods which are exportable. So we really need to get our India's manufacturing sector going. India's manufacturing sector is quite taken in by the size of India's market, except automobiles, which are again driven by foreign companies. We are not exporting any major manufactured goods, of big ticket manufactured goods. That's where we have fallen behind very, very badly, even in the UPA time. I don't mind conceding that. But we have to focus on making India's manufacturing sector an exporting sector.
Devinder Sharma.
Well, I see there are a lot of emphasis on high growth rate, and your government and the present government all talk about high growth rate. But at this time when we are having such a high growth rate, we find that one section of the country or majority of the country is living in deprivation. If you look at 50% of the 50% of the population, which is agriculture, your government accepted that agriculture is passing through a terrible, terrible crisis. This government also accepts it's passing through a terrible, terrible crisis. The average income, economic survey 2016 told us, the average income of farming family in 17 states of India, which means half the country, is 20,000 rupees a year. I can't even imagine how these people who have 20,000 rupees a year as the income survive. You can't even rear a cow in 1,700 rupees per month. How does this family survive? And yet I find, if you look at the budget, the total allocation for agriculture is about 0.3 to 0.4% of the GDP. 50% population, and this much is the budget for agriculture. Does it mean that we have lost the plot on agriculture? Do you mean, why is this stepmotherly treatment to agriculture? And why there is a contempt for agriculture when we talk of economic growth? We just treat it as if it's a kind of a burden on the country.
Well, I don't know. I'm completely taken aback by your numbers. I'm sure you know your numbers better than I do.
It was an economic survey.
NABARD survey says the bottom 10%, bottom 20%, and bottom 30% of average household income, which is where most of the tenant farmers are, most of the agricultural labor is about 4,500 rupees per month for the bottom 10%. Next 10% is about 5,000 odd, and next 10% is about 6,000. And you are giving me a number which frightens me, that the annual average is 16,000. Yes. But I don't know. We need to reconcile these numbers.
17 states, the average income of a farming family is...
But what about the NABARD survey then?
NABARD survey, if you look at it, this was based on, I'm talking about economic survey. Even this, if you look at NABARD survey, the average income is 8,000 rupees.
No.
Now, the NABARD point survey, I'm trying to make is...
As I said, NABARD survey has given the average for the bottom 10%, then 11 to 20 and 20 to 30 is 4,000 odd, 5,000 odd and 6,000 odd. That's what the NABARD survey said. Anyway, we can't reconcile those numbers today. It is low, which is why I plead that we don't rubbish the idea of a minimum income support for the poorest of the poor. We put our heads together and we work through that idea and make it a success. It is not an easy idea to implement. It is a bold idea. I think given the size of India's economy, 200 lakh crore GDP, and given the rate of growth that is being projected, it is doable, and we must find a way to do it, not find ways to shoot it down. Let's find a way to do it, even if we do it only for the bottom 10%.
You've already got those states like Telangana. The Raitu Bandhu scheme is now being quoted virtually by every chief minister as the kind of scheme that can win elections after the spectacular
victory of KCR. That's not our scheme.
No, it's not. You don't want a scheme like Raitu Bandhu.
The Raitu Bandhu scheme only benefits the land-owning class, which means it benefits the absentee landlord, it benefits the land owner farmer.
And you've got Naveen Patnaik, who's now come up with his Kalia scheme, which he claims precisely overcomes the very deficiencies that you speak about.
No, it doesn't overcome the deficiencies.
He claims. Again.
Well, that's the point. You know, you won't let us answer why those claims are not correct. I didn't even complete my statement on Raitu Bandhu. Raitu Bandhu doesn't cover tenant farmer, which is the overwhelming majority of farmers are tenant farmers. There the money will go to the absentee landlord sitting in Hyderabad or Vijayawada. It doesn't go to the farmer. It doesn't cover agricultural labor. Mm. It doesn't cover rural, non-farmer poor, goldsmith, blacksmith, barber, tailor, carpenter. It doesn't cover the rural, non-farmer poor. And it doesn't cover the urban poor at all. Therefore, the Raitu Bandhu scheme is a very narrow scheme targeted at a very small population, which I'm not questioning. Good for that population. But what I'm pleading for is for all the poor who are in the bottom 10%, the lowest decile, and then perhaps move up to the next bottom decile. At least the two rungs, 0 to 20%, must be covered by some kind of a minimum income support, which is our idea.
Why is it, sir, that every time some finance has to be given to agriculture, the question comes up, where will the money come from? If you have to write off the loans of the farmers. No, I'm not talking about you saying, but the general discourse is, where will the money come from for the farm loan waivers, for the kind of Raitu Bandhu schemes? But the moment you write off the corporate loans, the former chief economic advisor used to say, it leads to economic growth.
How can
writing off corporate loans, bad loans be leading to economic growth, whereas waiving the farm loans lead to credit indiscipline or the national balance sheet being spoiled?
I entirely agree with you. When I did the farm loan waiver, 100 questions were shot at me, where is the money coming from? Yeah. But I said, we will find the money. If it is the right thing to do, and it is the right time to do it, we will find the money.
Dr. Vyas.
I'm not Dr. Mahesh.
Mahesh.
Honorary doctor today.
Yeah.
So, we have been estimating the unemployment problem, saying what the job losses have been, how bad is the labor participation rate fall been, and that's all very stressful, all that is very fine. The response that we get from the government is that how can all this be true when we have had sustained 7% or so growth rate? What is your response to this conundrum?
Presumably, you're going to also ask that to Piyush Goyal. That's easier to ask him.
My response, please do not take it as a light-hearted response. It's a serious response. Well, there are eminent economists here. Growth rate is a deduction. It's a calculation. It's an inference. It's not somewhere there as a fact. Growth rate is an inference or a deduction or a calculation by statisticians. Whereas, investment is a fact. Credit growth or credit decline is a fact. Savings is a fact. Household liabilities is a fact. decline in labor participation is more or less a fact, a statistical fact. These are facts, these are inference. This is an inference. What the government is saying is, I have drawn this inference, therefore your facts are wrong. My answer is, the facts are right, your inference is wrong.
So are you questioning the GDP growth numbers?
Of course I question it. It's a fake number. If all these facts are there, and if all these facts point in one direction, this number is a fake number.
Interesting, because we have a former chief statistician with us. Are you throwing fake numbers?
Don't ask him, he didn't do that.
You know, I certainly am not. I don't think I did when I was there. Mr. Chidambaram would have hauled me up had I done so. But Mr. Chidambaram, let me ask you, there are really two questions. First is, before the UPA 1 record got kind of trashed by the CSO back series, you know, that is the highest growth period India had had on record. What did you think you got right? What is it that you did which was different and was right? You know, in the entire discourse that one has heard over the years, one hasn't heard this. The second part of the question is, having answered first, is, of all the steps that the Modi government has taken, leave aside the demonetization, can you think of one thing they've really got wrong?
What did we get right in the first 5 years, UPA 1? I think what we got right was, we infused confidence in small, medium, big investors that you can invest in the Indian economy. Investment touched a high during those 5 years. Savings were high, but investment touched a high of about 34% or something like that, 36% of GDP. Well, to be absolutely accurate, we didn't do anything wrong that would have dissuaded them from investment. There's Ashok Jha, see somewhere here, he was here. We didn't do anything disruptive. We didn't do anything which would have scared them. We didn't put fear into them. Maybe we did nothing and therefore they were very happy to invest. Maybe government should do nothing and let people invest. People invest. What Mr. Modi got it wrong was, well, I don't know why you keep out demonetization.
Because it's the gorilla in the room. Let's leave it aside.
Demonetization was so utterly foolish that I think there's no point bringing that into the discussion.
No, you're perfectly welcome to do so.
That's okay. I think what Modi did wrong was the centralization of authority in the PMO, which I know from talking to many people like the people gathered here and many others, has put fear in people's minds, has given extraordinary power to various agencies and departments of the government. Every regulator has morphed into a controller, including SEBI, including the Competition Commission of India, that people are telling me quite openly, but why should I invest? If I have to invest, let me invest abroad. Why should I invest here? Now, between I should invest under UPA 1 and why should I invest under NDA 1, I think that is the difference.
Interesting, we are eliminating UPA 2.
I did that deliberately.
Yeah, you want to come to UPA 2?
About UPA 2. I'm not.
What went wrong in UPA 2?
Well, what went wrong in UPA 2 was Lehman Brothers. I had no control over Lehman Brothers. Everything went wrong after 2008 September. And that continued for nearly 3 years. And when we were trying to pull back, we had this famous taper tantrum, which pushed us back another 18 months. And if you add 3 years and 18 months, that's about 4.5 years of UPA 2.
Before I go to the next round, what has Mr. Modi got right? Surely he's got something right in the last 5 years. Inflation is low.
Yeah, what he's got right is low inflation, but I don't know if he had anything to do with oil prices. Well, all right, I'll credit him. He brought down oil prices, if that's what you want to hear. I don't know if he has anything to do with, he had something to do with farm produce prices. He denied them MSP for 3 years. And as a result of that, farmers' acute distress is because MSP was denied. Virtually MSP increases was near zero in 3 years. And then he allows imports of agricultural produce when there's a bumper crop here. Today, we have paddy at prices lower than last year, chilies, onions, tomato in Andhra Pradesh is selling. A box of 28 kilograms of tomato is selling at 60 rupees in Andhra Pradesh.
The latest is turmeric now.
Therefore, if this is the kind of low inflation you want, economists will either bear me out or contradict me. High inflation is bad, but very low inflation is also bad.
Jaggi, yes.
No,
we'll go around and ask him one very specific question in the limited time we have. Yeah. Why don't you start?
Sir, what seems, Mr. Raghuram Rajan has said that the worst period of UPA 1 was 2006-08, when all the bulk of the NPAs accumulated. And that's what's causing the double balance sheet problem today. So if today the economy is in a mess, it's largely because of the irrational exuberance of 2006 and 2008 and not the Lehman crisis. So I think that's something that you need to answer, because I think that was a very, very irrational period. And what we saw was a government living on steroids, where there was 8,40,000 crores of oil subsidies given during UPA 1 and 2, and that's 1% of GDP on an average on a non-merit good. Just one item, fuel.
What do you do, Mr. Jagannathan, when the price of crude goes up to $147 a barrel? Tell me. It's all very nice for us to sit here.
But sir,
and say, is $147 a barrel? Let's load it on the retail price. Let it go beyond 100 rupees. If that is what you want to do, do it. But before, during and after, you will never think of being in government. You have to win an election to be in government to do a few things. And when you do a few things, when you're faced with this huge problem of $147 a barrel, what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to subsidize. And you're criticizing that subsidy today after 10 years, but sitting in that chair on that day, what would you have done? If you were prime minister, would you have loaded the entire price on the retail consumer? If you would, then say so. If I was Dr. Manmohan Singh, I don't care a damn about what the consumer has to bear. I will sell petrol at 100 rupees a litre. I will sell diesel at 100 rupees a litre. Please say that.
But sir, why are you now asking for a cut of 25 rupees in petroleum prices when the government is actually managing the fiscal properly?
You are taken in by social media distortion. I did not say that you can cut prices by 25 rupees. All I said was the price has been loaded by 25 rupees. Not that you should cut it by 25 rupees.
Yeah,
I'm disappointed that you should be taken in by social media distortions.
One big difference between UPA 1 and 2 was the social spending that went down quite significantly in UPA 2. Do you regret that?
What went down?
Social spending. Do you regret that at all? Do you regret the fact that
well,
you actually...
Well, all I can say in my defense is I was not the finance minister for 3.5 years.
Okay, as the government.
Therefore,
do you regret it as a government?
Yeah, but I'm collectively responsible. I'm collectively responsible. You see, we were facing a huge crisis of balance of payment, huge crisis of current account deficit, a huge crisis of fiscal deficit, and therefore social spending did come down as a proportion of GDP. In absolute numbers, I don't think it came down. It was always a little more than the previous year. But as a percentage of GDP, it came down. But as I said, these are difficult choices to make. External factors overwhelmed UPA 2 in the first 3.5 years. That you will concede?
Yeah,
well,
but
you're not saying no. Therefore, you can.
No, but
that.
You can't put it all on external factors. The manner, for example, in which the bank loans in particular.
I'm going to answer bank loans.
Yes, the irrational exuberance which Jaggi spoke about. I mean, these
irrational exuberance of bankers is what Dr. Raghuram Rajan said. Mr. Jagannathan dropped the word bankers.
No, he aided by a government also.
No, listen.
Which was ringing up bank directors.
I challenge you, Mr. Rajdeep Sardesai, to show me one case where one phone call was made to give a loan to anyone from my office. I challenge you here and now.
This is what Prime Minister Modi has been saying in speech after speech.
Mr. Narendra Modi is Prime Minister. He can get away with making anything. He will never sit down with you and ask questions. He will never sit down with me and answer questions. You are saying here in my face, you are telling me phone calls were made. I challenge you. I challenge you in writing tomorrow.
Did it happen in the 3.5 years when you were not Finance Minister?
You should ask the former Finance Minister, who is now a distinguished former President of India. Please ask him.
Okay.
But I challenge you when you make that statement.
Okay.
Don't repeat inexactitudes which are circulated in the media.
Sir, your successor as well as the Prime Minister keep making these statements.
You won't let me answer, Mr. Jagannath.
Yes.
I asked in Parliament the question to the Finance Minister, please tell us now, how many loans given prior to 2004 have become NPAs under your asset quality review? How many loans given between 2004 and 2014 have become NPA? And how many loans given between 2004 and 2014, which were evergreened after 2014, have become NPA? Please break it up into three parts: the Vajpayee government, the Manmohan Singh government, and the Modi government, and tell me this 10 lakh crore NPA, please break it up into three parts. I'm still waiting for an answer.
Mr. Chidambaram, I think we all agree that growth has to go from 7 to 9 or 10% to create the jobs we need. Looking forward, most economists would agree that the next set of reforms have to be factor market reforms: land, labor, power distribution, certainly health and education. The challenge is almost all of these come under the purview of the states. So really a fiscal federalism question: is there a facilitating role that the center can play? And can we use the model of the GST Council in these areas to try and strike some grand bargain?
The GST Council was and remains a very good idea. It also requires a great deal of diplomacy and statecraft to make that council work. When I tried to push the GST bill, I had two finance ministers who walked up to me and said, "Sorry, we are under instructions. We cannot allow the GST laws to be passed in your tenure." The finance minister of Madhya Pradesh, the finance minister of Gujarat. Meeting after meeting, they will say, "Sorry, we have no mandate to agree to the GST laws be passed." Now, fortunately, under the present GST Council, chaired by the current finance minister, the ministers seem to be pulling together. Nobody's obstructionist. GST Council is a good idea. I think it's an idea that can be replicated in other areas. But the caveat is, you should not be deliberately obstructionist. Even if two ministers are obstructionist, there is no consensus and you can't take a decision. So you must actually, while praising the government and the finance minister and the other ministers of the BJP for taking the GST process forward, you must also remember to praise that the opposition finance ministers in this council have not been obstructionist.
Mahesh.
I understand that you don't want to say what the Congress manifesto will say.
Because I don't know it myself.
Work under progress. Okay. Yeah. But can you at least share your views on jobs, labor reforms, growth of the medium, small companies into larger companies, because that seems to be, to me, the solution for job creation?
Well, I share your views on it. In fact, my team largely resources on your team for data. I entirely share your views. If you ask me the three big issues that faces the economy, one is jobs, two is jobs, three is jobs. Then you can now make it 1A, 1B, 1C, and I can go down the list. The point is, we have to find jobs. See, in India, there is a peculiar problem of jobs. We have to find jobs for PhD scholars and IIT graduates and IIM graduates. We have to find jobs for those who go through this BA pass course, which is completely useless. We have to find jobs for people who complete class 12. And we have to find jobs for 50% of students who drop out before class 8. We have to find all kinds of jobs. It's a mammoth task. It's a task that is so formidable that sometimes I despair.
So,
but we will have a whole section on jobs, and I hope that we will carry conviction.
Can you give some idea of what is the line of thinking on that?
Well, it can't be my thinking. It has to be the collective thinking of the Congress Working Committee. I am but a member of that committee. So wait for the Congress Working Committee to vet and approve the manifesto.
But the general political theory is that when you're in any committee, you usually have your way. But that's...
I don't seem to be having my way here.
Dr. Sen, final question.
Just to follow up on this, I mean, you know, what you said in response to my first question was, if I understood you right, what you did right was that you didn't do anything. You let people, those are your exact words.
Last part was frivolous. I said that we unleashed or helped unleash the energies of the investing community, big, medium and small, and they invested.
Investment
drove the growth rate in UPA 1.
I agree. And essentially what you're saying is that the government didn't get into the way of investors. Hmm? The fact is that same hands-off or sort of a telescope approach to the economy may be good for investments, but it's also very good for scams. And the charge that I think that was levied just now was that that's where the scams came up, although you haven't got the answer from the current finance minister about, you know, where the NPAs originated. But do you really think that the right way to actually run an economy is for removing government oversight over what the private sector does? We are looking at the opposite situation today, I admit.
I have a line in one of my columns, which I hope will find a place. See, we'll have to get government out of certain things. We'll have to get government into certain things. We have to get government out of most production and most services. We'll have to get government out of that. I think government is the biggest obstacle to investment, to innovation, to adaptation of technology, and to experimentation and risk-taking. But we'll have to get government into a few things. The government's capacity to deliver education, primary education, government's capacity to deliver primary health care, the government's capacity to deliver law and order for the socially and economically vulnerable sections of society is appallingly low today. They can't protect tribals, they can't protect Dalits, they can't protect minorities, they can't protect women, they can't protect children, and they can't deliver nutrition to children. Despite years of ICDS, you saw the numbers about stunted children and wasted children. They can't deliver primary education. You saw the ACER report year after year. Therefore, when you say get government out, I would only humbly suggest we'll have to get government out of many things. We'll have to get government into a few things.
Just a quick follow-up. Yes. And again, you referred to two institutions specifically in your reply, SEBI and CCIE, right? Both these were created to get government out.
Absolutely.
Regulators. And you actually identified these two as being the main bottlenecks in investment today. How are you going to reconcile that contradiction?
Well, this is based upon my experience in the last 5 years and looking at it from outside. I think in the last 4.5, 5 years, these two, among others, have gone far beyond regulation. They have more or less become controllers. We'll have to ask them to pull back now, give up all these control functions. By the way, I had a chat with Raghuram Rajan, therefore I make bold to say this. Have you read the RBI regulations? Has anyone read that whole book? No one can make sense of the RBI regulation. This is one of our premier regulators. And Raghu agreed with me, this whole regulation has to be rewritten in English. The book is in English, but it has to be rewritten in English. Therefore, that is how we have to get into this Competition Commission, SEBI, look at their specific decisions that they have delivered in specific cases, and tell them where they have crossed the line of regulation and got into controlling.
Okay, I think we've run out of time. We'll get you and others to ask questions to the other finance minister from the NDA.
There's only one finance minister, you know. No other finance minister.
The NDA finance minister. But Mr. Chidambaram, if you had to, you've mentioned Raghuram Rajan four times. There's much buzz that the Congress has actually offered Raghuram Rajan some kind of post should the Congress come to power. Is that true or not?
Not to my knowledge, but I think Raghuram Rajan is eminently suitable for public service.
We leave it at that, whatever that means. Okay, Mr. Chidambaram, thank you very much, and to my jury, which will stay on the stage, because now they will have further questioning. Thank you very much for joining me. Ah!